instruction. My name is Thuy and this is Lainey. She's a dancer from New York City and she's here on my invitation to giving some dance lesson to Saigon Swing Cats. There's some Saigon Swing Cats in the room.
Yay!
So today we're going to be sharing with you swing dancing as how it was created, some history, and how we can see communities were built, and you can see the very important role of accidentally or directly is all the role of women who were trying to build communities around this. And so we're going to take turns talking, some talking points. I'm going to show some the pictures and videos. You can have any questions. We're going to do a little bit of demos. We're going to give some classes by the end. So just let's make it an interactive lesson, session. Because the lesson's in the end.
Yeah.
All right. So I will give the class. Do you want to say something?
So essentially, the history of swing dancing starts in the 1920s. There's a little prehistory to that, but we're going to be mostly going from 1920s until today. And we have a couple different things for you. We both have some notes because there's a lot of detail, so if we use some papers a little bit, just making sure we're getting our dates correct for you. All right, so let's take a look at our first video we want to show you. And this is about women's empowerment. That's the theme of the month here at the consulate. Therefore, we wanted to really highlight some of the women that were important in Lindy Hop and swing dance history, as well as highlight some of the things that changed for women socially with dancing. And without ado, we have the first video.
Maybe before that, I would like to talk about the pictures.
Oh,
here.
Yeah, let's talk about the pictures.
We just created this slide this morning. And this is the Savoy Ballroom. That's what we're going to talk about in a little bit. This is everyone dancing in the Savoy Ballroom. And this is. Who have seen this picture before? Maybe the Savoy Ballroom, not many have seen, but have you seen this picture before?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Flexing the muscle.
Okay. So we modify a little bit with our name because like women we can build and do anything. So let's watch the video.
So this video doesn't have any sound because it was recorded in 1939 at the World's Fair. Number one thing we want to notice is that almost everyone in this video are women. It's women dancing with other women in 1939. This was something that wasn't necessarily a modern thought until about that time. And we're going to go through how did history come to this point where it was socially acceptable for women to be out on their own. A little bit of context about the 1939 World's Fair was in New York City, where I'm from. It's also where Lindy Hop was created. So this was part of this exhibition of showcasing New York City created this dance. We want to show it to the world, and all these different bands would play outside in the pavilions, and this is literally just a video of people social dancing. They're not performers, they're normal average people that are enjoying their day out at the fair. Now, the World's Fair ran for 2 years, 1939, the beginning of 39 through the end of 1940, and so some of this footage is from different periods in that time. If you go onto YouTube and you search for this, you'll find even more footage of performers doing the Lindy Hop as well. So, but number one thing, we have these women dancing with each other. And that's something that we don't see in lots of recorded history or videos. And this is one of the best examples that we have of women taking charge in that context. little bit to remember, 1939 was when World War II was happening. The United States were not involved in the war yet. So there were still men back at home, but not as many, since there was some war efforts happening to help aid Europe at the moment. So, all right, so where did all this come from? Like, why do we have this dancing in the 1939? Like, where did Lindy Hop, what is Lindy Hop, what is swing? It comes from a dance called the Charleston. And now Charleston is named after an island in South Carolina. And it has its roots in African dancing on the slave plantations. And so some of the movements comes from this dance called Juba. If you can look up more videos on that, but it has to do with this like wild movement. It's very rhythmic. And so Charleston, originating in the South, is from these people that were descendants of a slave population in the 1920s. And one thing that happened was the music of jazz started to become popular amongst people that were white and black. To remember that the United States was very segregated at this time in the 1920s, there weren't as much cultural influences that crossed over from black society to white society. Charleston was one of the first things that became adopted into white society that wasn't so, it wasn't changed as much as other forms of culture that were adopted. And it was popularized in a Broadway show called Running Wild that was in 1923. And a musician called James P. Johnson wrote a song called The Charleston. And it's got that very classic, like, ba, 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 da, 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 which every person who's like been to a wedding where people are dancing like Gatsby dancers, that's the song they play. And so this song, The Charleston, became a craze everywhere in the US. It started growing. And women started to dance this, and where they would flap their arms, and that's like you see in the second picture, their arms are all flapping like birds. That's why they would call them flappers. And flapper dancers was something else they were imitating. Well, people thought they looked like birds. They weren't actually imitating birds. And something about the Charleston, though, is that it was one of the very first dances to change the community. Most dances prior to this were either performed or danced socially. They weren't done in both ways. Charleston was something on stage and danced by normal people in ballrooms or on the street and to live music. So a couple things that are interesting about women in this is that it was one of the first dances socially acceptable for women to dance by themselves instead of just with a partner. So some of the partner dancing in Charleston, I apologize if our cords get in the way. Partner dancing in Charleston, I'm gonna be in the leader role right now. Traditionally, leader role was done by men until, well, you know, we saw in that 1939 video, women can lead too. So it's a face-to-face dance. This is called closed position, and we're just gonna have our little like, da, 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 da. This is very 1920s Charleston. It's got lots of like kicking, there's like a little head wobble thing. So this is in the simplest form, it was essentially like stepping on the beat.
Is it because most dancing like in ballroom was more upright and very European, so it was a bit like a bounce here. So the Charleston was so close to that area that it's already here compared to the Lindy Hop is more down here.
Yeah. So when our Charleston is very face to face, like the partners can look at each other instead of purposely turning away from each other. This is a very personable dance. As well as like some solo stuff that's very similar but can be embellished as we like. It's just like kicking, flailing arms, it's this common like flash of that.
Yeah, that's what you can do by yourself, which is more freedom for people to just, if I like the music, I just dance. I don't mean the partner, but like all the old school ballroom dances would be. So in the 1920s, it was also called the Roaring Twenties, where a lot of fun and freedom, a lot of artists are coming from that area. So with the Charleston, and then you're gonna go to the
Way. All right, so from Charleston, we have a new dance that starts to form. Now remember, Charleston, everything in Charleston was either done face-to-face to your partner where you're holding their back or you're in contact with your partner's back, or by yourself. So everything was closed position or solo. Mm-hmm. Unlike this next dance that we're gonna do, we can go next slide. Which is called Breakaway. And these are some images of some of the first dancers who created that. We're gonna demonstrate Breakaway, and then we'll talk a little bit about what Breakaway is, why it's a precursor to Charleston. Who are all these people? And Breakaway is like a little quick, slow. It's an 8-count step, and we're gonna have our quick, slow. So it starts in closed position, quick, slow. We open up. Back in, quick, slow. We open up, back in, quick, slow. And eventually they would change this handhold to something that looks a little more familiar to our swing dancers versus our ballroom and our 1920s
charms. We need to be up here. Let's do this up on here. So
here's our breakaway, quick, slow. Quick, slow.
Come here to
the
uphole. Now
we just so we can change the hole. So this position where there's no contact on the back, this was something brand new to dancing. It wasn't allowed in like the dance contest form, and it wasn't something considered socially acceptable to let your female partner go away from you until the breakaway. So in our breakaway, there's a video from 1929. We're not going to show it because it's kind of a long clip, but it's from 1929 in this film called After Seven. Seven is a horrible, horrible racist way of spelling seven because it's the 1920s in the USA and everyone wants to take the black population and suppress them. So After Seven in 1929 is a video of a dance contest. And it's a movie, a mainstream video, but they had actual real professional dancers film one of the scenes. And you can find there's two dancers, Shorty George Snowden and Pauline Morse. And they're the third couple to go on in this clip. And they, instead of dancing the Charleston, they're doing the breakaway. It's one of the very first examples we have where the partners break apart from each other and continue dancing versus just doing solo movements. So their first generation of Lindy Hop dancers, our first generation of swing dancers, these are people that learned in the ballrooms, which we're gonna talk more about in a bit. And they're people that weren't necessarily trained in partner dancing. They became partner dancers because of the culture in the 1920s and 30s and 40s where you don't know what you're doing on a Friday night, you go to the ballroom to dance because the band is playing. So we have Shorty George Snowden, and he is on the end here in the picture. He's very short. He's known for his signature dance move, the Shorty George. Let's totally demonstrate. Uh-huh, the Shorty George. It's like a kick and down. We can Shorty George at each other. And he was trying to comically mimic that he's really, really short.
So it was short on you. Just love thighs.
Totally. Yes. So that's Shorty George, and one of his early partners was named Big B. That was her nickname, Big B. Her middle name was B. And she was really tall. She was about 6 feet tall. Shorty George was about 5'1". He's my height. And they would do these comical routines. If you go on YouTube, search them later. They have these really funny routines where she picks him up. And it's one of those examples where tall woman gets to do something that would not have been acceptable 10 years prior to that. And Lindy Hop became a dance, and swing dancing became a dance where people said, oh, you're doing funny things. Is this something that maybe the older generation wasn't okay with, but the younger generation embraced that? So before we talk about the rest of these people briefly, let's say, what is Lindy Hop and swing? We've kind of mentioned these words a lot, some of those people who aren't swing dancers in here. Swing dance is a umbrella word for a lot of different dance styles that fall under the type of jazz dancing. And swing is a type of music that is also a type of jazz music. So swing is traditionally a very specific range of songs that have a very specific type of beat to them, a swing beat, which means that the rhythm itself is off of the main tempo. That's what syncopation is. It's like a one, a two, a one, a two, a one, a two, a one, a two. So that offset is defining swing, which makes it very different than our Charleston dancing. So we use the word Lindy Hop to mean something more specific than just swing dancing. Swing dancing today means Charleston, it means Lindy Hop, it means Balboa, it means breakaway, it means shag, it means solo jazz. We're gonna touch on some of those things. So these dancers, some of them were doing breakaway, and then they were the ones who created the earliest version of Lindy Hop. So Lindy Hop in its early version looked a little bit more like the Charleston dancing that we demonstrated and the breakaway. Now, a couple other things, Leroy Stretch Jones, Little B, they were the opposite of Big B and Shorty George. She was short, he was tall, so they did some like kicky acrobatic things with her legs in the air. And we have Twist Mouth George and Edith Matthews. One of the most interesting things about them was they created the swivel step in our Lindy Hop. Now, there's a story that says that Twist Mount Jones is the one who was credited with the creation of the step. And we wonder, why was a man credited with creating a step that the women popularized? So we're going to demonstrate what that means, what that step is. And there's an 8-count version of Swing Out has evolved at this point. We're talking about 1930, 1931, 32. As opposed to 1929 after 7. So this breakaway step has turned into, let's go with this angle. The breakaway step has turned into this 8-count with a triple step rhythm because the music evolved from Charleston to swing. So as the music changed, the triple step was added to reflect the syncopation in the actual music. So we're gonna start with the original Swing Out, the signature move of Lindy Hop. Was started as a rock step for both partners. We have our rock step, triple step, 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 triple step, rock step, triple step. And instead of a rock step there, Twist Mouth was said to have seen his partner do a twist twist, as the description says, which we now call a swivel, and he was said that he taught that step to other partners on their dance team that was run by Shorty George. So the swivel step instead looks like 5, 6, 7, and a 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6, 7. It's got this big twist, twist, triple step, 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 triple step, twist, twist, triple. You see, I didn't change anything because I'm the leader role. So that's one of the reasons it's so interesting that they credit this
to the model of role.
Too bad. When we kind of think that it's possible that Edith Matthews created the step, she's just not credited with that, since most of history was told and written by men.
Right.
So,
yeah. And nobody verified now, and everyone are dead now, so no one can verify that. They just have very big doubts, like how come it's such a follow-up move. But maybe all the leaders
Leaders making swivels too, with a twisting step as well. If anyone is familiar with Frankie Manning's autobiography, we will mention him a little more later. This story about the twist is in his book, and he also backs it up that Twist Mouth created this step. So there's a lot of information about dancing, and ultimately everyone is sharing ideas together because we're learning in an environment that is social. It is not something that teachers stand in front of the room and teach you in a classroom where people sign up for class. that wasn't done in the 1930s and 40s with swing dancing. It was something that people went to hear the band, they would see other people doing a movement, and they would try to imitate them or mimic them. And those people that really loved dancing, they would sometimes create little practice groups to share ideas with each other, which is how the twist came about in the Lindy Hop. All right.
Should
we play a little bit of swing music just so you understand? Because I have not played. Yeah, let's do it. And the corn pocket. That's fine. Yeah, that's a good one. So this is a song called Corn Pocket. You can hear the swing in this beat as opposed to like a ba 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 ba. Swing, 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 well, let's see some swing up so this.
Yeah.
I'm sure the twist will end. Renaissance, where a lot of the culture in New York City from Harlem, which is known as a very African-American neighborhood in the northern region of Manhattan Island, became something that was all of a sudden cool and hip. And all of these white people wanted to learn black culture. So this is a very famous map that was drawn in the probably the late 30s, early 40s of the nightclubs of Harlem. And you can see that there's tons of places to go dancing. Small's Paradise up at the top, that's a very famous place. We have Cotton Club, where a lot of the dancers performed. I'm like, here's the Cotton Club down here.
not hang out, right?
And the most important place on here, though, is the Savoy Ballroom, which is over here, the Savoy Ballroom. And this ballroom is one of the most important places in the history of Lindy Hop because it was one of the very first public places that was desegregated. White and black people could go there and dance together instead of being separated off. A lot of these other spaces, such as the Cotton Club, was for white patrons only, but all black dancers performing. Whereas the Savoy Ballroom just had this big space that said, okay, we want everyone to come here and dance. And it was opened in 1926 by a Jewish man and a black man. His name was Mo Gale and Charles Buchanan. And this ballroom was one of the largest ones in Harlem. It spanned an entire city block. And on the second floor is where the dance floor was. They would open all the windows. And so people would hear the music playing on the street. And then people would dance on the streets as well, the Savoy Ballroom. So it opened March 12, 1926. It closed in 1958, and they knocked it down in the 60s to build really ugly apartment buildings. So if you go to New York City, you can find a plaque that says, the Savoy used to stand here, but thanks to the 1960s progress in America, it's just not longer there. Its nickname was the Home of Happy Feet. Tweet's going to tell you a little bit about some of the music that was played there and some of the important roles it took. So, there were, Yeah. Well, so in the Savoy Ballroom, one of those things about this place was it was where Ella Fitzgerald got discovered. Yeah. So it's really important to note that. Oh, let's go back a slide. Let's go back to the one. Yeah. Is it? Look at this picture down the bottom here. Look, it's women dancing with other women.
Yay! And this was probably in the early 50s or late 40s.
Mm. Yeah, that photograph, based on their style of their clothing, for sure. This ballroom was something that people would go for inspiration, and they would go there for fun. Every night of the week, you could dance there. All of the dancers that we're going to be talking about in the next slide, especially, all of them are people that were the discovered swing dancing at the Savoy Ballroom.
Yeah.
Cool. Now let's go to the next one. So, there's a group of dancers called Whitey's Lindy Hoppers. We highlighted a few of the names in yellow are the ones that we're going to talk about the most. This was part of what we call the golden age of Lindy Hop, about 1935, 1945, give or take. But that's mostly because that's when a lot of footage was filmed that we can see and study today. It was also when a lot of the dancers became something a little more professional and actually got hired to perform at gigs and perform overseas. And when Lindy Hop and swing dancing and this big band music started to spread across the world, not just in New York and the USA. So we have the Whitey's Lindy Hoppers was founded by a dancer named Herbert Whitey White. The nickname of Whitey came from his hair, actually not his last name. He had a white streak in his hair. He used to be a boxer, and at the Savoy, he turned into a bouncer at the door. So he started to see all these really great dancers there, and he was like, I should create a professional group, because instead of being a bouncer, I think I could get all these dancers jobs as performers. So that was one of the first times that Lindy Hop as a dance was something taken seriously in a professional context, instead of just seen as something that, oh, those young kids are doing in the ballroom these days.
So it happened so that Whitey Hibbert. So he saw all these kids always going and hang out at the Savoy, and they always have some dance competition or a little showdown to the live band, and all of these got to outdance you. So all of these get competitive, and then Whitey think maybe it's a good idea, we're gonna pick some good dancers, put into a group, and we can make a show. Because in New York, it was very, I went to New York once and I saw it's very a big show city. A lot of, my tickets were everywhere for the shows. And so we talked about Frankie Manning. Do you think Frankie Manning is his nickname is the ambassador of Lindy Hop. He's one of his other nickname is Muscle Head. Because he shaves his hair, and he was a little boy seeing his mom always throwing parties in the house. It's called the rent parties, and so everyone was dancing on the table, on the couch, and on the table, and everywhere in the house, and everyone would go to the house and pay a little money to help the owner of the house pay the rent to the house. That's why it's called the rent parties. And then he tried to get up, he was maybe 12, and he got up and tried to dance, and his mom told him that, you're too stiff, you cannot dance. And he was a bit sad. And then he grew up with his mom, raising his mom, very important woman to raise him up. And he went hang out in the Savoy, and he just interested to see Shorty George Snowden, the short guy, and he wanted to be like him, the role model. And he was George, Shorty George was the first one who do like the breakaway and get into the Lindy Hop. But it was Frankie Manning who make Lindy Hop to the next level with the air step, which we don't have to do today. It's gonna be injury. We have to go to family practice later.
We will show you a video of the air steps in a few minutes.
In a few minutes, in the video. Beautiful. So that's Frankie Manning. And
so it's worth talking about the female dancer who created the air step with Frankie, because everyone's like, wow, Frankie did this thing, but
to make the girl fly.
Yeah, but you know what, it took someone with a lot of courage to let a guy flip her over.
Was in the air.
So her name is Ann Mills. Ann Mills was, we highlighted her in yellow. She was one of Frankie's original partners competing with him in the Savoy Ballroom in competitions and in another contest called the Harvest Moon Ball. And together, they're the ones who created the first air step where Frankie flips her over his head and she lands on her feet. And like a miracle, the first time they tried it in Frankie's living room, it worked, and they were like, yeah, that's our new thing. So we also have a dancer named Norma Miller that is someone that's very important to the history of swing dancing. And you want to talk about Norma a bit?
So Norma Miller, Frankie Manning, it's all of these people on the names here, they all passed away, so no longer with us. We had some time with Frankie Manning and Norma Mueller because they were brought back to the swing revival, which we're going to talk about in a bit. In November, we're going to have a big global celebration of Norma Mueller in New York. And basically, Norma Mueller, I have never met, but she has met in some classes. She was a big show girl. So she was like 14. She won a contest in the Savoy Ballroom, like really, really young. And she went in and she won, and she also got into the YT Lindy Hoppers group, the cool kids, and get to go show around. And because she was so young in the group, she outlived a lot of people. And then she was in a lot of show business. She went around making, she had, she was in the, she was dancing on the sidewalk. Before she was dancing on the sidewalk, and then she went in and won it. And this is her quote. So the Savoy was our community, and the dance floor was the place we found freedom. So that was she went on television and made a lot of shows. She even she even went to Vietnam during the Vietnam War in the circulate of 1972 to entertain American troops who were in the war. So of everyone here, she's the only one who made it to Vietnam. It was in 1972.
So Norma and Frankie are some of the important people because of our revival. We're going to mention them again, as well as Al Minns. And we're going to see video of all of them dancing in 1941. In 1941, we have a really famous video that was made in Hollywood. It was part of a movie called Hell's a Poppin'. Apparently some very famous filmmakers created this. And we're going to watch the whole thing through. It does have sound, so it'll be... there's some music to listen to. This choreography was made by Frankie Manning, and this video itself is considered the best example of Lindy Hop in that era. So it's worthy of studying. So this is William Downs and Frances Mickey Jones.
Wow.
They were all responsible for choreographing their own little piece, and then Frankie choreographed all the ensemble sections. This is Norma Miller in the chef hat dancing with Billy Ricker. She's, I think, 17 in this video.
17?
Yeah, 17 or 18, yeah.
Thank you.
This is Al Min's Dancing with Willamette record. Al Min's, we're going to mention him again later. This is Frankie Manning dancing with Ann Johnson, his partner in Whitey's Open Hearts.
So how's the popping? Is it the name of a movie that lost the Lindy Hop if you get a past 6 months, you would probably know the most because of this dancing. A little bit of California cuisine. We're going to do some black clothes. A lot of aerials, where people are in the air a lot of time.
Which aerials weren't something down on the social floor.
But in performance, and super practice, so we don't redo this. If you go to the Wednesday dance or the Sunday dance with the Saigon Swing Cats, we will be doing something like this. So don't be disappointed because we want to be safe for everyone.
In performance, though, you end up seeing a lot of things that try to imitate and mimic How's a Poppin', because we really think of this as like, that is Lindy Hop, but we have to remember it was performance Lindy Hop by professionals. Not the average person going to a ballroom and dancing on a Saturday night, Lindy Hop. All right, so we have a little documentary that becomes one of the most important pieces of history called The Spirit Moves. It was created by a woman. Her name is Maura Dien. She was a Russian woman, and she moved to the United States when she was a young teenager. She went to the Savoy Ballroom in the 1930s and saw dancers. She fell in love with the dance. And it's a picture of her in the middle. She's pictured here with Al Mins and Leon James, two of the Whitey's Lindy Hoppers. And she ended up filming this documentary for about 50 years. She was creating footage of it. And it's a history of African-American jazz dancing from the early 1900s all the way through the 1950s and 60s, because swing eventually created a dance called bebop, which I personally think is boring. But Maura Dien has all this video footage, and if you watch any of it on YouTube or if you have the DVDs of it, there's hundreds of hours of it. It's the music is dubbed on top of it, of most of it. So even if you're watching How to Learn the Trinky Do, that song is not what they were dancing to in this video. So a lot of the footage is just like black and white footage of her saying, hey, I'm a dancer, I want you to do this specific style. And then there's a little subtitle saying about that subtitle. But without Maura Dien and her vision to actually capture the original dancers doing this dance, we would have lost so much of our history of swing dancing. A lot of us instructors and teachers and historians and people who love swing dancing study these clips and these videos, which were not on YouTube when I started dancing. I have the DVDs.
Lots of DVD, VHS. Somebody has to be like, oh, do you have that? Even in the tape, the video. And people have to turn that. Luckily, we were born like in this day and age where people have had the effort to go and make everything digitized so that we can have and share it easier.
So now you can see The Spirit Moves in its entire form on YouTube. But you can also search for specific dance styles or specific dancers, and it'll come up with The Spirit Moves clip of them instead of watching an hour and a half of one piece of footage. And so, you know, Maura Dien becomes someone that's extremely important to bridge the gap from swing dancing in an era where it was its heyday, it was super popular, and all of a sudden, it wasn't popular anymore. And swing dancing became something that was in decline. The ballrooms were closing. World War II ended. People came home from the war and they didn't want to be reminded of the times before the war. They didn't want to be reminded of the friends they had lost or the youth that they had. And instead, they were focusing more on having families and moving on with their lives. And so in the 1940s, we also see an increase in the technology. So the technology for recording movies and videos and audio became better. So people, instead of going to ballrooms to hear the bands, they would hear them on the radio. And they would hear the bands like on their gramophones and anything that they wanted to play in their home, instead of going out to hear the live bands. So bands stopped being hired. There wasn't as much money in these big bands to put on shows in ballrooms. As well as the popular music became rock and roll, which was where people had like five players in a band instead of 16 or 17 people to pay in a big band. So dancing, swing dancing died for a while, mostly because musical change, history change, cultural shifts, and the end of World War II and with the new technology. And it's something that, if we didn't have people like Maura Dan having created these videos, we would have only had some really old stuff like Hell's a Poppin' to see. But today, there's a little bit of a revival happening. And the revival started prior to what we think of as the revival, actually. There were a few different people in the 1980s who, they found the video Hell's a Poppin'. They were like, I kind of want to learn that. I don't know how it
is. It sounds so Swedish in a very far away, like, right? It's not American. It was found in European, because I heard, I went to visit this thing called Herrengen Scamp, this is in there. It was Sweden. And all of a sudden, there was something that got very trendy to be retro and vintage. And all those people, they're like, okay, I want to look at old movies and study the style. And this looks cool. So let's try to dress up like them. And now that we dress up like them, what else do we do? Now that we just dress up like just like this and walk around, we go to work. But in the movies that we saw, there was a lot of entertainment. So that, let's also try to dance like these people on the movies. And they saw the video, but it was a bit difficult to just imitate. You know, if you are very, very talented dancers, you still don't know how to dance in the right spirit. And then I think those people realize that. And they dig up some yellow pages and try to find all of this white team Lindy Hoppers, because they were the show people, so they were famous. There were a bit of names and advertising promo everywhere, so they found these people and try to bring them up one by one and say, would you like to come over and teach us how to dance like you? So this is what happened with the swing revival. That's the beginning in the early 1980s. When I was being born, and then there was the revival was happening, and then now I can dance this.
So the first dancer that was found was Almans, and so the Swedish dancers found Almans because he was actually teaching at a dance studio in New York called Sandra Cameron, which closed about 10 years ago, but I remember Sandra Cameron's studio in New York as a place that people
so you said that the Lindy Hop and swing dancing was on the decline because of many things happened, cultural shifts and everything. Even the music was changed. It was swing dancing and now it's either bebop, where all the musicians just play for themselves. Because there were no dancers, they just, okay, we might as well just play for ourselves, or just rock and roll, and then, okay, we don't care. We're gonna go to a different demographics and just dance. But it was not completely dead. It was still surviving, and then in different
slowly surviving. There was a group of dancers led by someone named Mamalu Parks, she started dancing in the Savoy Ballroom in the 1950s, 60s, so she was a very late era dancer. She kind of kept a group of dancers performing around New York City. And the death of Lindy Hop is just that it was something really small and it was barely had a heartbeat. And so when these Swedish dancers actually found Al Minns as the first one, and they said, Al, can you come to Sweden and teach us here? It was the very first time that a dancer in the last 50 years had traveled somewhere else to teach people, as well as it was one of the first times that it became like a studio class as something that became normal instead of just, I'll show you a few steps. So Al Minns started creating an actual curriculum for these Swedish dancers at this Harang dance camp, which is still going on today, and it's one of the largest camps in the world. Another one of the dancers that was pulled out of retirement was Frankie Manning. He was working at the post office in New York, and people said, hey, Frankie, I finally found you in the yellow pages, and can you show us some moves? So Frankie was mostly known as someone who wanted to teach everyone how to dance. He passed away in 2009. I was fortunate to get to meet Frankie and Norma. Al Minns passed away in 1985, so he was someone that, if he had lived a little longer, he probably would be really important to us today as we think of Frankie and Norma R in our local communities now. Now, Frankie wrote a book, so everyone can read his book, and about he'll be ambassador of Lindy Hop. And he was someone that in his 80s and his 90s, he was dancing and teaching and sharing his love of this Lindy Hop dance. And Frankie was someone that he just had this big smile and he wanted everyone to dance. He just wanted everyone to love dancing as much as he did. He didn't care if you were a new dancer, if you were a beginner, if you were someone who was a professional. He just wanted everyone to love the music like he did. And that's one of the reasons Frankie becomes one of the important figures, is partially his personality was just someone that we could latch onto and say, you're our hero, we want to be like you, we want to imitate this dance like you. It wasn't just because he was such a great dancer at the time. Because all of the Whitey's Lindy Hop dancers were amazing dancers in the 1930s and 40s, just that Frankie had that personality that was magnetic, and everyone wanted to be Frankie's friend. So another dancer of the era, Norma Miller, she was nicknamed the Queen of Swing because Norma was someone who actually kept dancing in her dance career. As Tweed mentioned a little bit, she went on to create stage shows in Las Vegas. She toured with her own group of chorus girls that were performing jazz dances. She created popularized a famous routine called Trickeration. And Norma did this on her own as a woman in the 50s and 60s and 70s, and that's really rare. She was someone who just had this really strong personality. Norma passed away earlier this year, so it's very recent that we've lost her. So some really big celebrations planned for her upcoming, what would have been her 100th birthday in November and December. So if you were a Lindy Hopper, check out the Norma Miller celebrations that are going to happen.
You might want to teach the Norma Miller Trickeration routine. So,
So even though these groups of dancers were like, oh, I found these new dancers and we're going to create this new Lindy Hop, it wasn't popular in Maine culture until the 1990s, where we have this, a couple movies came out, Swing Kids, Swingers, and there was a very famous commercial called Gap Khaki Swing. And that was actually danced to an original song from the early 50s, late 40s of by Lully Prima's Jump, Jive, and Wail. So this neo-swing creation of this pop culture, all these bands that were playing neo-swing music, which was inspired by swing, a little bit of rock and roll, a little bit ska. However, the music itself doesn't actually swing. It's got a very steady beat. It's just played fast enough, it sounds like it swings. However, it got a huge generation of people dancing to this music, and all these people became interested in, like, I'm gonna wear the zoot suit, I wanna dress up. And then as that time period slowly became a little less popular, the dancers that realized they loved the dance started to discover what the Swedish dancers already did discover, which was the original dancers and recreating a culture from the 1930s into today. So there's some festivals happening today that have been going on since the 80s, some of them since the 90s, that are really popular, and a lot of these higher dancers that are teachers today, as well as they try to bring back the old dancers and kind of help create some of this history and keep it alive.
So, for example, now we have all six continents all have swing communities, like Saigon Swing Cats. And now it's got even back to Africa. We just had a little festival in Saigon, and we had dancers from Mozambique, where swing dancing was not originally from them, because it's originally swing dancing was in the African American communities in Harlem, New York. So this is the African who stay in Africa, they just didn't know until that some people from anywhere travel to Africa and like, oh, we love this African American, and they just like, what is that? We only do like this dancing. So it got, you know, go back, and now it's like share for everyone. We have dancing in the South Africa, in Mozambique, in Australia, there's a huge scene. In Europe, like I think like in Sweden or France or Lithuania, you have in Asia, not in that yet. In Asia, we have like a huge community of swing dancers in Korea, South Korea. I don't know about North Korea. Maybe they have some. I don't know. Maybe have some suspects on spy. So South Korea, Hong Kong, Beijing, like, yeah, I mean China. There are so many new dance communities pop up everywhere. There are some in Mongolia, some in Kathmandu. It's crazy. We have a Facebook page that I help admin with. It's called Asia Lindy Alliance. So they listed out all the dance communities of swing dancing. So it's amazing where swing dancing was originally in this like little part, which is some kind of dance with a specific group of people. Now it's just like, wow, everywhere. Like, so Lainey, when she wanted to do like, I'm gonna take 1 year sabbatical leave, I can just go everywhere and teach dancing, which is like not thinkable back in the days, even when Frank Kevin was around when doing the show, because not everyone understand what this is, so that they want to learn.
Yeah, nowadays there's way more social dancers than there were in the 1930s in different places, rather than dancers from New York performing for us. So we wouldn't have that today if it wasn't for Frankie touring around, teaching different communities, and Norma helping spread that as well. And we're really lucky that we have these communities that we can all relate to each other for this love of this one old dance. So one of my absolute favorite idols of the dance is Dawn Hampton. Her tagline is "The light is on." This is Dawn on the right-hand side here. Oh, also on that side, that's Frankie and Norma in front of the Apollo Theater in the 90s, I think. They're about to go see a show. So we have Dawn Hampton. She was part of a musician, traveling band with her family in the 1930s and 40s, so she grew up singing on stage before she could walk. And Norma was someone that in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, or Dawn was in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, she was someone who was a cabaret singer, so she would be singing these jazz standards. And she was very big in the gay rights movement, so she would hang out in these gay clubs in New York. She was part of these big riots for gay rights in the 70s and 80s. And so Dawn was someone that was like really into alternative communities and just being like sharing this idea of this jazz music and this cabaret. She started dancing when she met Frankie Manning in the 80s and 90s. And so Dawn became somewhat that because she was this jazz singer and she was like always performing, dancing around on stage. She turned into someone that became a mentor for our swing dancing community because of the way that she felt the music. So Dawn started to travel in as in her 70s and 80s, and she was someone who spread this love of dancing. But Dawn loved saying, you have to feel the music, you have to feel the beat. She actually really liked Bhangra dancing, which is nothing to do with swing dancing. And Dawn would like try to perform Bhangra, get people dancing Bhangra. But the message of that she said that dancing transcends culture. It's something that we can do everywhere around the world, and we can get inspiration from other dances and apply it to our local dancing. And so Dawn loved feeling the music, and she thought that Bhangra was this essential dance of how we feel the music. And so she wanted swing dancers of today to stop watching videos and just start moving. And that was one of her ways of helping inspire people. Now, I love Dawn because of the way that she captured the feeling of a song. And I was very fortunate to have met and actually hung out with Dawn a lot in New York, because she would go out dancing every week. And you could see her dance with the band every time, every Tuesday in New York. And Dawn passed away about 3 years ago, but there's some really great video footage of her singing and dancing on YouTube. And we have one of my favorite clips to show you a little bit of Dawn's dancing. She's dancing with someone named John Dokes. He's a singer in the band that's playing the video. And she dances very differently than like you would see in the Hells of Poppin' video, because Dawn is just trying to have a conversation with the music and her partner. And it's something that you're gonna see. She's dancing at a festival that's in Washington, D.C. So you'll see there's tons of dancers in the background. So let's take a look at Dawn Hampton. This is her favorite song, Splanky. She's in like probably 81 in this video, I think, maybe 78. She danced this song so often with her favorite partner that it almost turned into a little routine that they did all the time. Like, they always did her signature moves with all the hits in the song. You see, people loved Dawn. She's not someone that was an original dancer. She was someone that captured the feeling of the energy and the music and wanted to share that with everybody. And as swing dancers in our communities today, we really try to find those pieces of the past and recreate, but also innovate and create new things about them and find ways to connect to each other using something that was from popular in the 1930s and 40s. So we're gonna talk a little bit about our modern society and what brings us together.
So, to link a little bit to the previous session, we talked about Frankie Manning, who is the ambassador of Lindy Hop, and he is someone who loves always inviting a lot of people to join him for his birthday. So lots of parties were created, and everyone wants to be his friend and want to come to the birthday. So I had the chance to be there in his 100th birthday without him. He only passed away when he was 95. So about 34,
right before 95.
So 5 years before that. So he already passed away. But because he said, like, it doesn't matter if I'm not there, I'm gonna have you always dancing in my spirit. And then you're gonna be dancing with Lindy Hop, so the Lindy Hop can live on forever. And since then, we asked, I think, some calendar to make his birthday, which is May 26th, to be the World Lindy Hop Day, because we have so many words, like we have the World Rhino Day, we have the World Elephant Day. So we asked, okay, can we have the May 26th to be the World Lindy Hop Day? And then it got approved. So if you put that in, you're gonna find a lot of celebrations of the World Lindy Hop Day, so it's gonna be May 26th. So this is a little bit of a movie
of Saigon Swing Cats celebrating the World Lindy Hop Day in Saigon with this little video made by a friend who just was in the audience.
Everybody who was anybody in Harlem wanted to go to the Savoy, to hear Chick Webb, to try to forget the depression, to dance to the brand new stuff.
So what about
room?
Yeah, that's
right.
Yeah, that's right. In June with the ambassador and the Consulate General. And this is us just last night dancing in a live jazz concert in District 3 with Professor Cunningham and his old school band. This is me dancing with another cat for the kind of strike. So that we should dance and love, and we should not burn or kill or destroy the planet. So we want to give some nice message. I'd like to join with the people who care for the environment and the earth. This is us dancing in the Rainbow Bridge, Gaohong, in District 1, in our going down the street dancing day. And this is us dancing the Shim Sham in the World Lindy Hop Day event. So dressed up a little bit, street clothes and like black clothes. So we're dressing different locations with different styles. So I have been dancing since 2006, and I was born in the year that herring dance came began in 1982. So I was looking for something to belong to, I guess, when I was in my first job and wanted to make some new friends. And then I found out that, oh, this
called swing dancing. It's something that you can dance on jazz music, and that got my attention. And then I went in and I tried out. Like, if you've never tried, I didn't know if anything like this existed. And so I went and I tried, took on a free intro class. And okay, I want to try how to learn this, the basic steps first. And then I met people and I met new friends. And I started to add pages on my passport of traveling just for this dance. Back in the day, it was so crazy. All my parents and my friends were like, why did you go there? Then you went last year already. Why didn't you go to another place? It was for Hong Kong Swing Festival. It's like, no, but my friends would go, so I want to go too. And you make some new friends and dancing. So it can have quite addictive effects. So I must warn. Sometimes people, it's like, I don't know why I didn't know about this. Or there are people who say, I would blame you for all of this addiction, because now I have to dress like swing, I have to buy new swing music, I have to invest in some clothes and accessories for swing dancing, and I have to go to festivals, I have to pay for classes, and it's just like a whole lifestyle. And it is how it is. You choose what your passion, and then you're gonna play it out. So I want to invite everyone, and if you have the chance to talk to your friends, you can always come and find us and join us in all of our crazy activities, dancing and making fun. So
here's a little bit about me as a dancer in New York City. As a promo reel, there's some really nice footage of the places that we dance in New York, some big festivals, as well as a little bit about my classes in New York.
Yeah. That's Gabriel.
Yeah. Contest. That's a contest. This is from Lincoln Center with Summer Night Swing, which is one of the big festivals we have in summer. This is a dance camp in New Hampshire. This is a dance camp in Cleveland.
This is called the Balboa.
This is a social dance in New York. That's my friend who actually came to visit here a few months ago. Third classes in New York City.
That was beautiful, everybody.
So you can see we sometimes dress up in vintage style, sometimes we kind of keep it more casual. And one thing that's important about our New York City dance community is we're really, really proud of where our dance came from, which is from New York. And so in New York City, I teach at a dance studio called You Should Be Dancing. Every 3 months, they kind of change the dance schedule, but I was the teacher who was in charge of some of the scheduling, so I would kind of help create the program for our swing dancers. And we'd always have our four levels of classes there for Lindy Hop. And those were 2 or 3 days a week, depending on which month it was, as well as I taught another dance style called Balboa. Which is in this picture here. And something that swing dancing for me was something I started to do in college in 2006.
We started at the same time.
So swing dancing for me was a way to discover who I was as an adult when I moved to New York from California. And I immediately went out social dancing after my very first class I took. And I immediately felt like I was part of a community, that I belonged somewhere. And it helped me connect to being in a new city, to being surrounded by a bunch of tall buildings. And all of a sudden, I was like, I had an identity, and I was a swing dancer. And so as I continued through college, I took all the classes I could, I started performing in our college. You can find some pretty funny videos of me on YouTube from 2007 and 8.
Thank you,
answer. Some really funny ones. And part of our dance communities in New York is we have lots of different studios you can learn from and take class from, but everyone always comes together, no matter which studio you belong at these social dances. There's Spring Pram Jam on Thursday nights, which was my first dance I went to. There's live bands at bars that play for free. There's like these big events that happen once a year in New York that have battle of big bands that are on aircraft carrier boats. And so we have kind of a little bit of everything in New York, but it's also a place where you get the opportunity to work with some of the other best dancers, but everyone goes through New York City. And being so proud of our history of the dance is something that when we go to other places, we like to brag about it. So I'm from New York. and I do miss it. I'm on a 1 year little sabbatical trip, but I was one of the people that helped shape and create the New York dance community. And as a woman without a male partner, that's something that I always had to work against. Because most people think of you as, I'm gonna hire you with your partner, or I'm gonna hire a male partner and they're gonna bring you along. But I was someone that was very, very strong to say like, no, no, I can do both dance roles. I'm proficient and I know what I'm talking about as a female. Like, I don't need another person to help explain that. So I actually was someone that would try to get a lot of the jobs and I would bring my own partner along instead of the other way around. Traditionally, even swing dancing today, a lot of the men get the jobs and then they bring their female partners with them. But I said, like, I don't need to do that. I'm going to get the jobs myself and bring along a partner that I want to work with. And so that's something that in New York we teach our classes alone at the studio I belong to. So I became really proficient at doing things myself. And that's something that I wanted to take on the road and help experience in other places and other scenes and other cultures for swing dancing, but also just say like, hey, I wanted to do this tour and I'm kind of done waiting for someone to like set it up for me, so I'm just gonna go and do it myself. So I'm really happy to have like another strong female that we can connect and create something together, and this is all because of this dance that we love. So a little bit of New York stuff there. We're going to go through talking about some of the events that we were both event organizers. We both run things for our community and create a space for everyone to come and learn how to dance, whether you're female, male, or however you identify. And this was some things that happened this weekend too.
Yeah. So if all the swing dancers were here, they were there in the weekend. We call Swing Yell Saigon Doi. So that's Lainey over there. This is gonna march. So this is not the first time we have been in public together. So Swing Yell Saigon Doi is when I and Lainey were there. You say, and my picture is not there. I'm not the artist. So we just have 3 nights, 3 days festival. We dance on the boat, we dance in the Sofitel Hotel, we have a beautiful rooftop, poolside sunset jam, so we can dance on. We love cats, so I think you love cats. So we want to make it like all the cast please join in. It's the name of a song as well, by Ben Goodman. A little bit earlier in May, we had the World Lindy Hop Day celebration. Before that, in April, we have Joe DeVille with the Ben O'Jen, and we have some wine. Want to organize a party so we can come dance and then invite people and dress up vintagely as the 20s. Last year we did a thing called the Saigon Swing Fest, so all of that we created with a lot of passion and heart, because we really want to carry the spirit of the old timers like Frankie Manning or Norman Miller or Don Hampton. I never met any of these old timers in person. I was in a Skype call group with Frankie Manning because I went to a dance festival in Singapore, which Frankie was supposed to be there. It was 2009, but he just had to replace his hips with some screwdrivers, so like, I cannot make the trip. So he was just got into Skype and he's like, hello everyone, this is Frankie Manning, so that I can hear his voice.
through computer technology. So that's how it goes. I never met Norma Miller, but I went to her next camp in 2 years ago, and I attended the Don Hampton send-off ceremony. So everyone, I never met the person that everyone you march from, like from this little land, you will march out to the sea, and there's someone on the boat with play a song with a clarinet, and someone would spread her ashes to the ocean, and you must feel there was some great spirit there. It's just like giving you goosebumps right now. But I think it's important for us as organizers and as professional instructor to get the original spirit of this dance, which is so long ago, which we were not born in that time, but somehow we find this connection and we feel that we need to do something to build more communities, strong communities, so that we can have more people joining in and maybe have all of you here. I hope that the sale is so obvious, so you need to come and join us and check out what all the fuss is about. Yeah, so our role to keep some history and to spread on to all of you and to get you got the dancing bug too.
Yeah, so this is an example of some of the events that I run in New York. On the top, we have an event called White Heat. It's a monthly dance for Balboa dancers. We always have a live band. Fortunately, we have a lot of great musicians in New York City. And that's a place that every week we was a practice session, and then once a month with the live music. But we encourage all of our dancers to dance whichever role they want. We have lots of advanced dancers who want to switch roles and learn how to do the follower or the leader role. And so even in our community, we wanted to push having like this equality from amongst leading and following, and so it's no longer connected to a gender role, it's just a title of which dance role you're doing. As well as a little picture of one of my Lindy Hop classes, making some promo stuff, because in dancing in New York City, there's tons of competition from other studios and other dancers. We always have to make a lot of our own promotional material to get people to come to our classes. And this is one of my big events that I ran for 4 years called Bal Week. It's a once-a-year festival. We have about 70 people. We bring in a band from out of town. It's a whole week long of dancing that we do in New York. And there's classes every day, different history talks that happen, and it's a big competition that we do. And in New York, space is really expensive to rent, so like running a big event is very difficult in New York. So two of my coworkers are continuing on this event while I'm gone. So if you want to go to New York in the beginning of May, go to Bal Week. You can learn a dance called Balboa, which is a type of swing dancing that also really reveres its old-time dancers and some of its history. But one of the things about event organizing is you get to create the event you want your people to attend. You get to make sure that there's this policy of equality, that everyone feels included, and that women have a safe space to come to if they're not feeling comfortable with someone or with something. And so that's something that we always try to encourage. And as women organizers, I think that's we are more aware of these issues than when men are organizing events, because we're the ones pushing for this comfortable and equality that we want at a dance event. So that's something that's really important to us. And you can see that even if these events that we're doing and organizing are across the world from each other, in Vietnam and in New York City, they're all similar in a way. We're all dancing to live music, we're all dancing this Lindy Hop dance that we love, we're all trying to recreate the spirit of this era from the 1930s, a little nostalgia in there, but we also are just trying to find that human connection with each other. We just want to have a way to relate to each other that's different than the way our modern society does with our cell phones and computers. So even though Lindy Hop is something that comes from New York, it transcends time, it transcends cultures, space. It transcends space.
So far, but they're so close.
So I think it's time we'll take some questions. We'll do this really quickly so that we can do a little lesson with you. So we'll do any quick questions. We'll go to the next slide of our fancy pants of like, we have New York, Vietnam.